At a time when the magazine industry faces an uncertain future, Dennis Publishing is thriving. 4 years ago, British publisher Felix Dennis brought Maxim, the leader of the so-called Laddie Mag industry in the United Kingdom, he brought it to the United States. The magazine with the beer and babes philosophy has gone on to become the number one men's lifestyle publication in the States with a circulation of 2.5 million readers. Dennis is a 30-year veteran of the industry who first came to notorious fame when he was jailed in 1971 on obscenity charges for publishing the underground magazine Oz. Today, his global media empire is constantly growing with the recent U.S. launches of the music publication Blender and the news weekly, The Week. I'm pleased to have him on this broadcast for the very first time. I like this magazine.
You like The Week, John?
Yeah, I do. I do.
Out of all the magazines that I publish and have published in 30 years, the only magazine that I'm absolutely certain will outlive me long, long after I'm dead is The Week.
Why is that?
I think, to be very honest with you, it's the best thing I've ever done. I think there's a huge need for a filter for all the information that people have to deal with. You know, there's just so much information, they just cannot read all the newspapers.
Let me tell you, I swear to you, this is an honest story. I'm
okay.
In London,
right?
Before you brought this to the United States.
Mm-hmm.
This magazine is in the back seat of the car that I'm riding in.
Okay.
I pick it up, because you know, I'm always thinking about television programs.
All right.
And I say, here is a television program.
Right.
Here is a television program.
And I think you're right.
You know? So I'm doing it, and I'm calling it The Week.
Well, that's okay. I'll send the lawyers around. I would love you to do
this
The Week.
We will. We'll do it together.
I'll tell you, I would love to do The Week with you.
It is a great magazine.
Could I just tell people what it's about?
Yes, please do.
Basically, it's got a line on the front that tells you what it's about. It says, all you need to know about everything that matters. And what we do is we create 40 pages of magazine, of which only six are allowed to be ads. We limit the amount of advertising,
right.
And we're the only magazine, as far as we know,
right.
In America that actually does that. We condense the news stories from literally hundreds and hundreds of newspapers around the world, obviously mostly in the United States of America, and we try to produce a witty, amusing digest that takes precisely 1 hour and 10 minutes to read. And when you finish it, you feel like a prince. I know everything.
I tell you what, I mean, it really is fascinating. I mean, look at this. This is the main stories, faith-based revival, serious. It wasn't all bad. This is about Chicago's Field Museum of History. What the columnist said, editor's letter from
right.
William Falk, what's next,
right.
And it goes on and on. I mean, it really is.
We even introduce something that I think is pretty terrifying as far as American publishers are concerned, and
what's
that's
that?
The page after that page, which is
talking
a map
points.
Of the, an actual oh. map of the world.
Oh,
I mean,
my God.
First of all, America, and then on the
right,
next double page
right.
spread, you'll see the whole double page spread is a map of the world. And everyone always tells me that Americans don't care what happens around the rest of the world, and I don't believe that's true.
Absolutely not, as long as you tell them stories.
And as long as you keep it short, snappy, witty, and amusing, and we are totally bipartisan.
How is it, though, that the man who publishes this magazine...
Maxim. Wonderful magazine.
Pretzel Sex.
Yeah.
Teleportation, Living Plastic, blah, blah, blah. Thou shalt not share an umbrella, 50 rules of the game.
Better one up the top right.
Tyson Talks, okay.
Tyson Talks, we're all ears.
Stuff.
Sorry.
This is another thing, Sex with Strange, blah, blah. You know, the best cities in America for
yeah.
women. How does a man who produces this stuff,
yeah.
which is okay with me too, but I, you know, produce this?
I love magazines.
Yeah.
The sole answer to that is, I've been in love with magazines ever since I bumped into them professionally. By selling them on the street in the King's Road when my hair was
yeah.
down to my pants. And I've loved them ever since, and I'll probably go on publishing magazines till the day I die.
Is it fair to say that publishing this, with the success of this, gave you the money and the comfort and the security to do this?
It would be wonderful if I could say to you, Charlie, you're absolutely right, but you know what?
Wrong.
I actually got most of the money from publishing computer magazines. And also because out of the computer magazines, I invested in a huge American company, which we invented called Micro Warehouse, which
right.
we've long since sold. But those computer magazines and that big company, Micro Warehouse, that gave me all the money to be able to publish whatever magazines I want. And The Week was one I wanted to publish really badly.
How long? Recent origin? Or
it's no, I'll tell you the story. It's a wonderful story. A newspaper reporter, John Connell, in the Daily Telegraph in Britain, put his house on the market, got a mortgage, took all the money, took his wife and children and put them in a cottage in the country. She wasn't very happy. And he put all of his money on the table and launched the week. Everyone told him that he'd fail. I met him 6 months later. He was literally bankrupt. I had to virtually write the salary checks that minute without owning a cent of the week if we were to keep it alive. Since that time, he's thrived to the point where, as a sixth birthday present last month, the week's subscription, the number of paid subscribers in Britain, passed The Economist. That ain't bad.
No. Now, but here's the criticism.
Okay.
It's too short. It's too headlining. You don't really get the kind of in-depth coverage you get
anything. It's a digest. It is true. It is impossible to deny the fact that it's a digest. But when you look at the number of places at which the full story is available, I think there's a place for an intelligent, witty digest, which becomes, most readers tell us literally, it's like heroin on paper. You get it, you get through it every Friday, the weekend's coming up, you know everything.
But you have a sense of what's
going
on.
You have a sense of everything. You're skating on the surface of life,
yeah, exactly.
I accept. But at least you don't look like an idiot.
Well, that's right. It's not at least something you can refer to.
No,
and here's the great thing. If you want to know more, you know the kind of thing you want to know.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the
sure.
sense of curiosity will take you to know more about the subjects you really find you're interested in.
Sure.
Whatever the story is, you can go to the New York
Absolutely.
Times, or you can go to
Absolutely.
Newsweek.
We give the web URLs of every single newspaper from which we've helped condense things in every issue of the week on the back page. So if you want those full stories, you go straight up to their websites. And basically, it's a celebration of the fantastic newspaper culture that exists in America and exists in Britain.
Would you like to own a great newspaper?
Do you know, I think
like
that
Rupert
would be
Murdoch
a very, very dangerous thing for me to do.
Why?
Because it's whenever guys or women end up owning newspapers, you know, their prejudice is showing something furiously. I'm not sure that I want the temptation of all that, you know, power in my hands.
Yeah.
I'm not sure about
Oh, you really
that.
Don't?
I don't think
you
I
wouldn't
want that.
Felix to have a place that he can sound off.
No, I sound off plenty as it is. I don't think I need to bore the rest of the universe with my opinions.
How about broadcasting?
Broadcasting is really interesting. It's something that I've never really got involved in, although I do have appeared on a lot of radio shows in Britain, and I enjoy radio very much. But we are now actively in negotiations or discussions, perhaps would be a fairer word, to create a Maxim channel here in America.
A Maxim channel?
A Maxim channel. Huge, hundreds of millions of dollars of investment and stuff. And that is fascinating to me. Fascinating to me.
To me, too. And I don't know what's been written about that, but would this be a cable channel? Obviously, be a cable channel. But would it also be a satellite channel? Which? More likely a satellite channel, isn't it?
There is a huge debate with the two very, very large organizations with whom we are in discussion. And one of them favors the former route, and one of them favors the latter route, and I've got no idea where we'll end up. But I do believe that in a year or so, there will be a Maxim channel, and I think it will be a knockout success.
What would it be like? I mean, what might we find on the Maxim channel?
That's kind of what we're figuring out right now, Charlie. You know, and if you've got any ideas, you know, put them on the back of an envelope.
Well, I mean, Tyson Talks, that's
good. Yeah,
that
Tyson Talks will be absolutely great.
But I mean, you know, you've got to fill 24 hours. You know, it's 7/24 right there, 24/7.
It's 24/7, and, you know, we're used to just coming out once a month,
exactly.
or with some magazines
exactly.
once a week.
How do you think you have gained the circulation you have with this magazine when there is out there GQ,
yeah.
Esquire?
Yeah.
Playboy's not your competition, is it,
no,
or is it?
No, it's
not. No. Who is it? I mean, what is it you know that has readers coming to your magazine?
The problem is, I am going to tell you, but the problem is that, as I tell you, I know I'm not really doing, I'm doing myself a disservice, but I'm going to tell you.
All right.
Basically, men around the world are pretty much the same. They have similarities that...
Do I want to hear this?
Yeah, you don't want it. You want to hear it. And women are too.
Yeah.
And they, the women have always had a wonderful general interest magazine press. An absolutely wonderful general interest magazine press. I mean, that literally stretched, you know, all the way from Good Housekeeping, you know, to Cosmopolitan
right.
and beyond.
Right.
Men never had that. And
well, what would you call things like GQ and...
That's about... GQ calls itself a fashion magazine. I mean, it is a fashion magazine.
Okay. Well,
and basically, there was never a general interest men's lifestyle book because conventional wisdom in our industry has always been the same on both sides of the Atlantic, and in France, and in Germany, and in Italy. You can't do it. It can't be done. It's got to be a car magazine, or it's got to be a guns magazine, or it's got to be a yachting magazine, specialist magazine. And I always thought that was baloney, complete baloney. And so in the end, what you've really got here is a general interest men's magazine. That is the truth of the matter. And of course, it's led by girls in bikinis.
Right, right, right. I mean, and sex sells.
Sex sells for Gucci, sex sells for Ralph Lauren, sex sells for Calvin Klein, sex sells for Maxim. I'm not going to try
anybody
and be
who doesn't acknowledge that simply is fooling themselves.
They're just lying, basically, or fooling themselves,
yeah.
To be kind.
Now, but sex sells in what way? And what's the...
Maxim is
it pictures, or people really want to read stories called...
You see, if it was just sex sells, then Maxim would have been done.
Positions.
If it was just that sex sells, Maxim would have been done by American publishers 15 years
ago.
The facts of the matter are that sex on its own often doesn't sell.
Right.
Certainly, nudity and the kind of photographs that you will find in top shelf magazines, if you want to call them adult magazines,
right.
If you want to call them that, that embarrasses a lot of people and everybody, and they don't want to be seen with it too much. Basically, Maxim is about an attitude. Humor is the thread that runs through the entire magazine. I noticed that in various women's magazines, they talk to their readers in different ways. And we realize that men talk to each other in one-liners, even as I'm sitting here with you.
Yeah.
Never met before. And what do we do before we go on air? We're sitting there talking in one-liners. Because that's how men speak to each other.
Right.
My best buddy in the world died literally in a hospital bed in my arms, shooting off a one-liner.
Yeah.
And this guy was dying. That's how men talk to each other, and what runs through Maxim is this thread of humor and one-liners and your tongue in your cheek, and it doesn't really matter anyway. It isn't that important. There aren't that many things that are that important. And it's witty.
Now, was details an effort to
it
match
was.
You?
It was. Details were not an effort to match us, because it came before us, long before.
Okay.
Details was an attempt. It was a downtown New York, magazine for really hip people who are in the know.
Right.
You know, what's happening on the club circuit? Who's doing what? Who's wearing what? Who's going out with what? And it kind of worked while it was an independent operation, and then it got taken over by a corporation. And once it was taken over by a corporation, it withered on the vine. It would be very hard to keep a magazine like that going in a very large corporation.
Here is what I hear you saying, though. It's got to have humor.
It's got to have humor.
Kind of one-liner thing, but it's got to have what it really seems to have to have. Every great magazine that I've ever known mm-hmm. has a editor with a vision, a sense of what we are, and
mm-hmm.
an attitude.
Yeah. Let me just. Of course, I would have to agree with you, otherwise I'd be the devil incarnate. But we do not subscribe to the philosophy of celebrity editors.
Yeah.
Magazines, for me, or at least at Dennis Publishing, whether it's Blender, Staff, Maxim, whether it's Auto Express, whatever it is, is a group effort. And for me, the idea of the celebrity editor, America has taken the whole concept of the celebrity editor to the most ridiculous extremes now. Absolutely ridiculous.
Well, many are there, though?
I mean,
you know, some of the women's magazines, you know, you've got Tina Brown, and you've got Anna Wintour.
All I can say
I wouldn't call John, you know.
Well, all I can say is that I myself certainly do not subscribe to the idea of the celebrity editor. Mm. I do not think that magazines are totally driven by editors. I think you need a great editor to lead a team, and it's the team that does it. Some of the best ideas in this magazine come
the
from
great
the youngest.
Editor, without a great editor with a sense of who the hell we are, you know, a team won't. A committee has never made anything happen.
No, I'm not saying it's a committee.
A committee didn't create Dennis Publishing.
It's not a committee. It's a team. There's a big difference between a team and a committee. If you've ever played sports, you'll know that.
No, I do. Of course, I know that. But every team I've ever known has a leader.
Yep, and that's absolutely true. So far, Maxim has reached, the numbers of copies that it's reached, about whatever it is, 2.6, 2.7 million now. And it's on its fourth editor. Explain. It isn't the editor. It's what lies behind the idea of the magazine. In fact, it's the readers, actually. The readers drive this magazine.
I agree. And Ben, how silly it is for me to sit here and tell you what an editor is about when you have all these successful magazines and I don't edit a magazine. Mm-hmm. But somebody's got to set the direction of a magazine. You've got to say, this is what we are. This is a sense of it. Then, once that's done, you can shuffle in editor after editor after editor after the ship is in the water and it's headed in the right direction.
I agree. What you need then is somebody who can keep the magazine fresh and keep it on track. But I don't subscribe to the idea that magazines are as good or as bad as their latest editor, which certainly has been the fashion in the last 10 years, magazines here in New York.
Blender, just tell me about Blender before we talk more generally. This is, well, Janet Jackson is on the cover here.
Yes, she is.
Yes, she is. The queen of pop is back.
Yes, she is.
Tim McGraw conquers country.
Yep.
Radiohead, there's a good story.
Uh-huh. You know, it's an excellent
trying to get them on this program.
Interview.
We're not doing so well.
They're a great band.
They are. U2.
Yep.
Bono was just here.
And it's a real interview. It's not just made up.
Oh, really?
No.
You don't make up interviews?
No, we don't make them up.
So you got a real
interview. A lot of people do actually make them up.
Do they really?
Yes, they do. They put them together from the internet.
Do they really?
Yes, they do. Mm. It's just completely unbelievable.
So you actually sat down and had one of your great reporters sit down and talk.
I'm saying that this magazine is something, this really is something different. This is a try at something different. Basically, what we believe is that whilst there are some great music magazines here in America, and I would say the greatest at the moment, of course, apart from my own, is The Source.
You would say what?
The Source would be the greatest music magazine in America.
Now explain that to me, because I'm not as familiar with it as you are.
The Source is
I'm not familiar with it at all.
Okay, so the Source is a wonderful magazine, and you should certainly bring Mr. Mays, who invented it, onto this program. It's a magazine about hip-hop and hip-hop culture and stuff, and it's a brilliant, brilliant magazine, and it's selling hundreds of thousands of copies. It is unbelievably successful.
Better than Vibe, better than all those other magazines that responded to the hip-hop.
Yeah, it is in that environment it's the best. But what we believe is that people don't listen to just one kind of music. We actually believe that they listen to all kinds of music, and that music today is very fragmented and fractured, which is why we chose the name Blender, and why you've got a country artist in there, why you've got Janet Jackson in there, why you've got U2 in there.
Radiohead.
You know, exactly. All kinds of, there's Weezer in there. I bet you've never even heard of Weezer.
No, I haven't.
Well, I can tell you.
Death, Madness, Pocket Protectors.
There you go. Well, that's a bit of Max, so we couldn't help that. That just slipped in.
Dr. Dre, Motley Crue, Elvis.
Motley Crue, Elvis, absolutely.
Angelina Jolie, what does she have to do with music?
Well, she's trying.
So this story, she'll get you. The Source, is that the name of the magazine?
That's the name of the magazine.
You don't own this magazine.
I don't own it at all.
You have no interest
in it. I'm not shilling for anybody. This guy is just a brilliant guy, Mr. Mays, who created this magazine. And
you know
him? It's a wonderful magazine. I do not know him, but I admire
his work.
You will
now, I guarantee you.
Okay, he's a great guy.
Yeah.
Great magazine.
So what are you trying to do? Are you trying to beat him down?
No, nothing to do with him. Because that's a niche publication, and what we're trying to do, however big the niche, it's a niche publication.
Right.
What this is an attempt, and I'll be very honest with you, to do what Rolling Stone did brilliantly 30 years ago. But my belief is, and the belief of many other people, certainly in my organization, that Rolling Stone has virtually ossified. I mean, It is an institution, and like all institutions, they become very, very uncomfortable as times change.
Why is that? Let's assume, I'm sure Jan Wenner would love to come on here.
Oh, sure, beat me up.
And
I'm
beat
sure.
you up.
And he would.
Tell you.
I'm sure he would. And you're welcome, Jan, you're welcome.
I mean, he probably would say, are you crazy? We're constantly reinventing ourselves while we keep to the original.
Yeah, he probably would say that, but the numbers don't show that.
Are they losing steam on
it isn't great. I'm not going to sit here and diss. I'm not going to sit here and diss
really?
Rolling Stone, but it isn't great. It isn't. It is not
so
great at
all. So you think they're ready to be taken?
I don't know if I can take them, but I can give them a hell of a run for them.
Can you really? You mean Blender is going to be a challenge to the great Rolling Stone?
You believe it?
The Bible of rock and roll.
You should have heard what they said when we first launched Maxim.
What did they say?
I think that the editor of one of the magazines, who I won't mention, that you mentioned earlier on, that's been around for a long time, a men's magazine, I think his prognosis was that we'd sell about 100,000 copies. That was, welcome to America, Felix. Not realizing that I've been publishing in this country for 29 years.
What have you been publishing in this country for 29 years?
The first thing I ever published in this country was I did a licensed publication for Steven Spielberg way, way, way back. I started out and for Jaws, the movie Jaws. And then I went on with my partners, Peter Godfrey and Robert Barton, still my partners today, 29 years later. And we published magazines and books and all kinds of things for every movie that Mr. Spielberg made and every movie that George Lucas made, right the way through for years and years and years and years and years. So you went all the way through the Star Wars, you went all the way through the Indiana Jones, all the way through the Close Encounters and all that stuff. And I thoroughly enjoyed doing all that publishing. It was a great time.
You've made a huge amount of money.
Yes, sir.
You're like 50th richest person in the United Kingdom.
Maybe
higher. Are you higher than that? I mean, where do you think the number is now?
I don't know.
Oh, come on, be bashful for me.
I'm not being bashful. I don't know what I'm worth. If I knew what I was worth, I could tell you. I don't know. You know, whatever you say, Charlie.
No, I don't know either, actually. But you don't need to worry about money. And you bought whose house in Mustique?
I bought David Mao's house in Mustique.
And who owned it before David?
No one owned it before David. Although I own David Bauer's house now in Mustique, I've got to tell you that house is still David Bauer's house.
Really? Because what he put
his heart and soul in that house, yeah. And it is a beautiful house. I think one of the only houses in the world that's ever been on the front cover of House and Garden and Architectural Digest. It is a beautiful house. I admit that straight away.
Now, why would David Bowie want to get,
all I can say is around the time that David, sold the house to me, he had married his wonderful new wife, Imam, and maybe that had something to do with it.
Really?
Who knows? I don't know. But
he has an apartment here in New York, spends a lot of time here.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
Yeah, but his spirit lives there, huh?
If he walked into his house, even after the millions of dollars that I've spent improving it, he would instantly see his own imprint stamped there as firmly as ever. It's a beautiful Balinese, it's built on Balinese principles.
Wow. What are Balinese principles? I don't know what they are.
Architectural principles. That is that the rooms are twisted so that air flows through them in certain ways. And the whole house is what's called an inside-out house, where most of the day you don't even realize there are rooms. Sometimes you're walking through rooms and you're not quite sure it is a room. It's only at night when all the doors are slid to to keep out the mosquitoes that you actually realize this is a room. So it's and the Balinese have been living with these types of courtyard inside-out houses for hundreds of thousands of years.
How often do you go down to Mustique?
You're not going to like this answer. I spend 3.5 months a year in Mustique.
Do you really?
I do.
But you can do anything you need to do there. You've got all.
I can do anything.
You've got the internet. You've got computers. You've got all kinds.
I can do anything.
Satellites and everything you need
exactly
to communicate.
I do have satellite there. And I can do anything I want there. But I spend 3.5 months. I figure it's not worth having a beautiful house like that unless you enjoy it. And I keep it open 11 months of the year, and I put 150 people a year through the house.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
And it mixed down the road, or is he?
Yeah, mixed down the road. Yeah, we were climbing a flagpole the other day. I won't explain to you why.
Why?
A fat, balding guy in glasses and one of the most famous rock and roll musicians in the world are climbing a ladder to go up a pole. I won't explain to you why, but we didn't fall down, and the insurance company didn't get hit.
You described the four horsemen of the magazine industry, and why are these significant to the future of the industry?
I'm not in the I've given that speech on many, many occasions.
I know you have. That's why I'm bringing it up.
And those four horsemen, if I can remember them correctly.
I'll help you with them. The emergence of sophisticated digital media.
Right.
Yeah. Number one. Environmental disapproval of the use of trees for paper.
Yes.
Growing functional illiteracy among the younger generation.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. The increasing cost of launching a magazine. These are the four horsemen of the magazine industry.
Right. Yeah. Those are the four horsemen. In the very long run, and I mean the long run, the ink on paper industry is doomed. There's no question about that. Anyone who thinks different has got their head firmly in the sand. But I did say the very long run.
Say that again. In the long
run. In the long run, there is no question that the ink on paper information industry is doomed. And entertainment industry is doomed. There's no question. I believe that in less than 50 years, even the selling of secondhand books there'll be a feeling about it similar to that with people who sell ivory objects now, even if they're 200 years old, that there will be strong disapproval, although it won't be illegal.
So what are you doing in anticipation of that?
My friend, the life I've led, Charlie, my life expectancy at the moment, I think, is about 15 years, and I'll be lucky to get that. I won't be worried about any of that.
Not worried about that.
But after 50 years since the Second World War of the most glorious summer that, the magazine industry has just had the most glorious summer that it could ever have.
This
last 50 years that just went by since the Second World War and the 30 years that I've been in it, we have now entered autumn. And anyone that
the
pretends...
The autumn of our years.
There's no question. Less magazines are sold in America every single year than were sold the year before. Less magazines are sold in Britain, in France, in Italy than were ever sold before. You know, there's no question about what's happening. It's not happening instantly. We're not just going to roll over and die. It isn't just going to go away tomorrow. But we have entered the autumn.
Okay. And there's reason to believe you're telling the truth and you know what you're talking about. Having said that, though, but you're creating new magazines.
Yes, I am.
Hello?
Sure.
Hello?
Sure. Well, it's what I do. Whether your audiences were going up or down, let's hope they're going up, pray God, but whether they're going up or down, do you keep on interviewing people?
Of course you do. And you keep on creating programs. Of course
right,
you do.
But
in a sense, you're also thinking about all the future ways that you will communicate information. I am, and yeah. I'm sure you are.
We have one of the busiest, maximonline.com. There's my only plug. Maximonline.com is probably the busiest website for young men in America.
Okay, but
so of course we are.
That's an interesting question, because we've got to draw this thing to a close. That's an interesting question because, if you look at what's happened online, the success of online newly created magazines is not great.
No, it's not.
You know, now you're suggesting something else, which really may be the future of online.
It's a brand extension. It should be a brand extension.
And brand extension.
Yeah. I mean, I adore ink on paper. I mean, you know, what do I do when I'm not doing all the things they say I do in the newspapers?
Yes.
I sit and read poetry. What do I do? You know, I sit and read and write poetry. I adore ink on paper. You know, one of my great heroes, was the guy that invented paper in AD 105. I don't want to think about the death of ink on paper, the slow, long, slow death.
Right.
But I think I'd be a liar if I said it wasn't.
You'd be an ostrich.
I'd be an ostrich if it wasn't going to happen. Yeah, I'd be an ostrich.
What else do you want to do? What dreams do you have?
I'm going to become a famous poet, Charlie. Mm-hmm. I'm going to become a famous poet, Charlie. I've been waiting to do this for 30 years, and I'm going to do it.
How are you going to do it?
I write great poetry. I have people who have been my buddies for many years and don't care that I'm a rich guy. I was with them long before I had anything. And I've tested this out with editors of very famous publishing houses. And they say, this is good. You could do this. I'm a little worried about it because in the tough world of commerce that I come from, the idea of sitting negotiating across the table with a guy, you know, when you've been writing poetry, I ain't good, man. But I'm going to do it. That's one thing I want to do. Another thing I want to do is I'm going to cause to be planted the largest forest in England. That's another thing I'm going to do.
You're going to cause to be planted?
Yes.
Boy, that's a change, isn't it?
It is a change, but I've been fascinated by trees and obsessed by them. I even put together a magazine for the Tree Council in Britain called Tree News. And I adore trees. I've always sort of... And so I've been practicing planting tens of thousands of them for the last 5 years. And now we're gearing up to create this huge charitable trust in England. And we're going to create the biggest forest, broadleaf forest in England. Mm. We have hardly any trees in England. I don't know if you know that, Charlie.
I go out in the country.
We're less than five or six. It all looks great because we plant the trees around the edges of the fields. But when you fly in a helicopter, it's a hollow square, man. So that's one of my big ambitions.
In contrast to stunning when you're riding, I just came from Colorado. I was in Aspen for a week.
Right.
I mean, that's all you see are trees.
It's just completely, America has no idea how lucky it is with its high tree cover, which is a technical term for tree cover. In Britain, we're down to 5%. Germany has 23-24%. France has 22%. For a country to only have 5% of its land surface covered in trees is incredibly dangerous. Successive British governments have let us down since the Napoleonic Wars, been chopping them down and never replacing them.
What does it mean to you to have this book of poetry published?
It's going to be published, and it isn't going to be vanity publishing either.
It's not a vanity act.
It's not going to be a vanity act. Mm. I write poetry that has strict meter, that rhymes, that's easily memorable, and about subjects that make people laugh and cry. And I think what's happened in the last 30 or 40 years, in poetry is shameful and disheartening, very, very miserable. No one can remember a single line of it. No one is interested in it. And I'm not surprised. Unless you go back, 40 years and backwards and start to, start tumbling into W.H. Auden and even back as far as Frost and then even back as far as John Donne, unless you go back there, you're not going to find anything that you're going to remember. That's shameful. We don't have to put up with that.
Who's your favorite poet?
My two favorite poets, I suppose I'd have to say A.E. Housman, Like a Shot.
Sure, right.
A.E. Housman, Like a Shot, and then I got a toss-up. John Donne, on the one hand, and probably Robert Frost on the other. Yeah. Very simple stuff, really.
Yeah. Did you like The Invention of Love?
Yes, but with some reservations. With some reservations.
Felix Dennis, the man in charge, the man who created Dennis Publishing. Thank you. Pleasure.
Thank you, Charlie.
Lord Snowdon has been taking photographs of the rich and the celebrated and the royal for more than 50 years. A contributing photographer for Vanity Fair magazine, his subjects range from Marlene Dietrich and the mentally ill to Mikhail Baryshnikov and the British royal family. Although Snowdon maintains that photography is not art, over 180 of his works can currently be seen in a retrospective at the Yale Center for British Art. I am pleased to have him back on this program, having admired his photographs for a long, long time. Let me start with this. What is it you want to be known for? What is it that you care most about beyond family?
I'm not a stayer, really. I like change.
Yeah.
I like designing. I got enormous pleasure out of designing the aviary at the London Zoo in 1963. And that's still standing, and it's now a listed building, which is quite nice.
Yes.
I hope in a small way I've helped with designing wheelchairs for disabled people and fighting for equal rights and opportunities. And then there's photography. So I jump from one thing to another.
Yeah.
And I don't really have a favorite. I just do like change.
From one
thing to the other.
One thing to
and
the
one
other.
One leads on to another. I mean, when you very kindly introduced me, you left out, to me, an important part of the things I was trying to do, which is pictures of social problems. Rather,
I was the reason for my question is just that, to get to that. So, good point. And my impression is that's more challenging for you than celebrated.
Of course,
portraits.
Yeah, absolutely, but not. Not. I said in a book I did on London in 1958. I think. Photographs should be simple, make people react, to laugh, to cry, but not to wince, I hope. Now, those photographs of social problems mustn't be those taken by voyeurs, nor must they be taken by somebody who's trying to be a do-gooder.
Mm-hmm.
They're just showing, hopefully with a certain amount of love and understanding, what's going on in the world. In the exhibition, I haven't seen it yet, I'm getting there tomorrow.
The one at Yale.
What?
The one at Yale.
Yes, but it was done at the National Portrait Gallery.
Right, right.
And there I made the end room social problems. I painted black and had very, the photographs were quite small. And no music, not to stare, but to make people realize how lucky they are who were going round. I was told not to include them because they were too depressing. But they're not depressing. I think it would be a very lightweight exhibition if you didn't include those kind of photographs.
Hmm.
Much more important than
that. Where do you think your instinct to do that comes from?
Hard to say, really. You know how one thing grows out of another? I mean, like one of the great war photographers called Don McCullen.
Yes.
And he's a marvelous photographer. And I think it led from having been around quite a lot of hospitals and having worked on the Sunday Times doing social problems. That grew more and more into mental hospitals. And I had my grandfather was a doctor to do with lunacy, as it was then called.
Mm.
I didn't know where it came from.
Yeah, but all those things whetted your curiosity.
Yes.
I think
there's you never know where things come from.
Yeah.
They just happen.
And design?
Oh, design, because I come from a background I'm very proud of, which is still continuing now with David.
Yes, he designs
son.
Furniture.
But before that, my great-grandfather was the political cartoonist on Punch magazine in England. in the 1870s. Another great uncle called Alfred Messel was a German architect. Sam Hotchpotch, and but they were all in—they were nearly all in the applied arts. My uncle Oliver Messel was arguably the greatest stage designer in the 20s and 30s. My eldest daughter is now painting, so she's the only person in the real fine arts. We're all applied arts,
yes.
And photography is to me rock bottom.
And why is that?
Well, because I think that.
I mean, you know, when people say that, I mean, everybody's saying, you know, you're going exactly against the grain. As photography gains momentum, as it gains more momentum, and I mean, if you go to galleries in the lower part of Manhattan, you'll see more photography than you've ever seen before. I mean, it's status, it's growth, it's penetration.
And they're selling prints here, and huge amount of money. And I'm against that, too, because...
Well, why are you against... go ahead.
Because...
Why isn't it art to be able to see? Because what makes painting is what you see in your head and see in your eye.
I know, but...
That's where it starts, at least.
But people of my generation took photographs because they drew badly.
There you go.
It's quicker and easier.
Yeah, right. I hear you. No, I know. I understand now. Well, that and explains everything.
And it's got too highfalutin. Yeah. You know, it's considered in the fine arts, in the Royal College of Art, things like that.
Right.
Bring it down a bit.
All right, let's look at the photograph. Show me the first one, please. This is a great story here. Can you tell me the story?
Yeah. I didn't know
this is Marlene Dietrich. There she is.
Yes.
With smoke on the right.
Well, that I did in about 1957, I think.
Yeah, 1955.
Yeah.
I have the book in front of me, that's why I know.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, to end up with that one, she looked at them. She looked at all the contacts, very, very small. And it was about 3 o'clock in the morning. And she said, "Dear boy, I like this one, but I like the smoke from that one." And so I said, "Miss Dietrich, it's frightfully difficult to do that. You know, you should know it isn't."
Yeah.
"You print in the photograph I like, all right? You put the paper in the drawer, which is light proof. Then you put in the one with the smoke that I like, and you do that on top of it. Now run along and do that." And of course she was dead right.
She was dead right.
Yes.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Wonderful. Great technician.
Yeah. The next one is...
It was all long before computers.
Yeah, exactly. Next one is look at this. This is Prince Charles and Princess Anne at the picture gallery at Buckingham Palace in 57.
That's 57.
Now, someone would say that that's just, it's wonderfully, you know, it's so perfectly framed.
Well, just a very simple thing of two children sitting on the floor.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, I won't get excited.
The one on the opposite page.
The opposite page, that shows the Queen and Prince Philip looking down at Prince Charles and Princess Anne, correct?
Yes.
Right.
But well, I quite often used to draw.
This is 57.
I used to draw beforehand what it was going to be like, and then submit it, you see, for approval. And what in that photograph was going to be, they were going to be fishing.
Yeah.
And they had caught a trout out of the stream.
Yeah.
Which is a Buckingham Palace. And the Queen and Prince Philip were proudly looking on at their first catch of the trout. Yeah. You see. On the morning of the day, there was a wonderful lady called Mrs. Peabody who looked after me. In Pimlico Road, just down by David's shop. And I opened the tray, and she said, "Well, I thought you needed building up this morning, Mr. Tony." And there she'd cooked the trout, you see, which is why they're reading the book.
Ah, that's a great story. All right, let's take a look at the next one. That's a Crufts Dog Show in Olympia, 1958.
Yes. Well, again, what I liked there was this a kind of campness of the man with the little hoary little dog.
Yes.
And the jealousy of the other the runner up and the old ladies in the background. It was just wandering around.
The jealousy of her expression. Her expression is just.
Have you ever been to Crofts or not?
No.
Oh, you should go.
Now we can see Alex Guinness. Best in show, I think. Alex Guinness, Hotel Paradiso.
Well, that was during a rehearsal. And I bleached the eyes out to make them whiter, yes.
Oh, I see.
And you see, in those days, nearly all stills were very, very small outside the theatre. They were 8 by 6 inches. And I wanted to have big exhibitions of photographs, partly out of conceit, but mainly to get people off the buses to go and buy a ticket. That was my job.
Yes.
And I also was working very closely with Peter Brook and Peter Hall. Right. All directors were then called Peter, I don't know why.
I know. And Peter Hall, Peter Brook, yeah, right.
And Peter Grenville. Right. But I started by taking photographs during rehearsal,
yeah,
which they loved because it took up less time. Before that, one used to go down in a motor car to Bournemouth. It was always seemingly in Bournemouth.
Yeah.
To have a whole day taking photographs with a great large plate camera.
Yeah.
Everything was completely false and lit. So I tried to make for more realism. It was the same time as Brendan Byrne and brutalism mm-hmm. that was coming mm-hmm. in.
Yeah.
And so I was doing it in a reportage kind of way.
All right. Let me see. The next one is Sir Laurence Olivier from The Entertainer, 1957. Most of these, look at that. Anything you did you do anything to this in terms
he
of
was wonderful to work for. And
why?
Well, we always find the great people, like here in Alec Guinness, they're never late, always on time.
Yeah.
They always seemingly have enough time for you, and however insignificant you may be. And immense charm, of course.
Yeah.
Now, those teeth were blacked out, that he put black paint
right,
down the center.
Right.
I had total admiration for him.
The next one is Charlie Chaplin. Look at this. This was 1966.
Yeah, it was quite a bit later. That was over lunch. And
you just pulled out a camera and started snapping?
Yes, well, I had one with me. It was on the table, I think. But after lunch, he said, would I like to see a film of his?
Yeah.
I thought, my God, think of just seeing a film, sitting next to Charlie Chaplin, seeing one of the great films. So he went into the drawing room and sat down. And he was working a projector, a very small, old-fashioned one. And the film was of he and Una, his wife,
right,
doing on a safari, and it lasted for 4 hours. It was the most boring thing I've ever seen in my life.
Sorry you ask. Accepted. All right, next is Princess Margaret, 1967.
And that's
is this your favorite photograph of her or not?
I do like it, but I put it opposite Baryshnikov because she's president of the Royal Ballet.
Yes.
And knows arguably more about the ballet than almost anybody I know.
Yeah.
And this is seldom recorded, really. Her knowledge is immense, and love of the ballet. And it was after when Rudolf Nureyev came, and he used to come and feed up with us and have steak, and all dancers eat like horses. You know. And then Baryshnikov was much, much later.
Yeah.
But
this photograph is 77.
Rudolph was very naughty, always behaved appallingly, in a lovable way, and always late. The only time he was on time was when I was photographing Baryshnikov, and he came behind.
He came behind to create
just
trouble.
To get in the picture.
Yeah. Okay, let's see the next one after there is Baryshnikov. Since we've been talking about Nureyev, there he is. I'm going to show Nureyev here
that's the one with
profile first, and then we'll show that. You know, there's the profile.
That's a very early one.
This is 1963, right?
That's when he came over.
Yeah. And then there he is with Margot Fontaine.
When they did the Swan Lake in Vienna.
In 1965.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they were marvelous together. And sometimes one should never praise just Rudolph. It was so much also Dame Margot.
Yes. Yes. Well said. Does Princess Margaret think that Nureyev is the greatest dancer she ever knew, you think?
Never said.
Okay, now we take a look at some children under stress.
This is questionable whether these pictures should be in the book. I think it's all right in the exhibition, but I worry about them being in a...
Because it trivializes them because it's among celebrity or something else?
And all of those things. I think it's very hard to have suddenly to change from a lightweight picture to total realism. I think it's all right in the exhibition.
I think it's okay in the book, too. Because it shows the commonality here. The common denominator is you.
Well, some of the things
I've tried, the same eye that took those pictures took these pictures.
Yes, but it's trying to show sometimes the love relationship between a nurse and a patient, which is very important.
Yeah. Just look at that.
And the toughness.
Look at her hands there.
Yeah. That was a very troubled boy.
Okay, the next one is, what's the next picture?
Oh. That's
Mental Hospital, Sunday Times Magazine, 1968.
Well, you see, what was wonderful about the Sunday Times was they gave me the opportunity to be these kind of serious photographs, yeah. because we didn't have to sell on the newsstand.
Right.
So before that, these problems had just been swept under the mat.
Now, was Harry Evans the editor then? Who was the editor?
Well, Harry Evans was as well
right.
afterwards.
Okay.
He was a wonderful colonel. What is he going to have?
Here's a, oh, that's just great. Listen.
This one.
Which one?
Well, where were you?
Well, I was looking at the one on the ocean front.
Oh, well, that one. That was somebody who was deaf and dumb.
Yeah.
And nobody had spoken to him for 3 years.
3 years? Look at this.
And as luck would have it, I do speak sign language. And so I went up and spoke to him. Nobody had talked to him at all.
Why did you learn sign language?
For a very good reason that it was during the war and we weren't allowed to talk after the lights were out, so we all learned sign language.
All right, next one is going back to more celebrated Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, in 1997.
Yes, wow. Well, there what I wanted to do was, it's a rather pretty chair, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a great chair.
And sort of chinoiserie. And they, I have photographed her quite a few times, and she's one of the most wonderful people in the world. But I wanted to do that one in a hat that she uses for fishing.
Yes.
And it's typical of her. And not many people see her like that.
Now, where was this photographed?
That was done down at her home in the country.
And the next is, let's take a look at the next one. Princess of Wales in 1991. That's a beautiful photograph.
Well, that one was quite interesting because I was accused of being awfully stuffy and really photographs were too uptight. And
yeah.
The reason for that was because they were for general release and they had to be, but that was one at the end of the sitting and I wet her hair.
Yeah.
And I never actually took it on film. It was done, do you know what I mean by Polaroid?
Too sure.
It was done on a Polaroid. And it got in, it just got filed in a scrapbook
yeah.
and never got used. And I sort of picked it out, or somebody said, oh, that one's rather nice and quite alive. And so I used that one.
It's a beautiful woman.
It was wonderful.
Wonderful.
Great loss.
Yeah. And then the heirs. You know, that's Harry on the left, isn't it? No, is that Prince William on the left and Harry sitting in the chair?
Yeah. And then very formal, that one, you see.
Yeah.
That was a chair that...
Have you seen them recently?
I photographed them earlier this year.
For? Private? Public?
For publication, yes.
Yeah. And Helen Mirren on the right.
Yes, I was trying to make...
Say it.
Greer rather sort of more feminine. It was done for Vogue. And Helen Mirren, she's awfully keen about her bosom, isn't she?
It's hard to, you know, she looks more like Helen Mirren in the mirror than she does here. Because there's something about, if I just saw that, I wouldn't necessarily know that's Helen Mirren. If I saw that, I would say Helen Mirren.
Well, that was just done in my small dressing room, which is tiny.
Oh, my God. Well, this is Emma Thompson. Take a look at this.
And it's that old rip-off of what, we haven't got it.
It's old rip-off of what?
Of Velasquez.
Is that? Oh, yes.
In the Velasquez, there's a cupid there. And I saw a cutting the other day and saying that it was a cheap because you couldn't actually paint somebody's head in a looking glass without getting yourself in the picture, which is absolute nonsense. I mean, I had the camera on a tripod here and you just get it so that you just get her head.
Wow. Great. How long did it take you to do that? I hope 2 days.
No, it wasn't. It was a morning, I think. It was, I borrowed the chaise longue, which was my uncle's, and I'd given it to David. And so he had to get it out of his flat. And he, at the time, had an outside iron staircase.
All right, I'm going to show the Kate Hepburn, but the last one, well, let's show the Kate Hepburn, then we'll show you the last one. Here. Is that great or not? That's her, isn't it?
That was done in New York.
Yeah.
And,
but that's the way she dresses, isn't it? That's not something you asked her to put on.
That's entirely her.
Yeah.
But it was wonderful. She was being filmed by the BBC just immediately after that. And
And did, was she cooperative? Was she?
Oh yes, no, she was wonderful. But the person from the BBC said, "Do tell me, what is star quality?" And she said, "I don't know what star quality is, but I sure got it."
She was right.
She's dead right.
Dead right. And so do these two. Take a look at this last picture. Richard Harris and Peter O'Toole at the Dorchester in 6 years ago, in 1995.
In the Oliver Messel suite, which was designed by my uncle. Yeah. And there they are with my tea set, you see.
Yeah.
Which was meant to represent teetotalers.
Yes.
Very childish joke.
Well, it's been a good, you were living a good life. Yes?
Well, I'm living.
Well, no, but you're living. I mean, you are, you're continuing to take photographs?
Yes, mm-hmm. Quite a lot. Not on this trip.
None?
No.
But I would think the camera's with you at all times.
No. Yes, it is.
In your pocket?
A little tiny, small one. No, it's not in a pocket. It's just in my sort of case.
Yeah, it's there, because you never know what you might see that you would regret.
But I've never been a great believer in lots of equipment. And
yeah.
You lose the moment.
Right. It's great to have you here. Thank you so much for coming.
Well, it was lovely seeing you again, and thank you for being so kind to David, too.
Well, say hello to David, and I mean, he's just, his career goes
well, I'm
on and on.
It's
and
wonderful.
On.
Yeah. It's lovely.
It's in the genes, maybe, huh?
Well, as I said earlier, it goes way back.
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's the point you made.
Yeah. Yeah. But, you see, he started working in my workshop, making things, and then I'm a terrible jerry builder.
Yeah.
And don't finish things off. But his work is so beautifully finished and crafted.
Yeah.
It's wonderful.
Thank you. Lord Snowdon, photographs by Snowdon. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.